Hello and welcome back to the Tower of London and inside the Chapel Royal of St Peter ad Vincula. Today is Sunday the 24th of January and it's the third Sunday after Epiphany. Gosh, how the year is already going past very quickly. This is the week of prayer for Christian unity, and it's on that theme that I want to spend a little time in this service. I'm grateful to David Suchet for reading Psalm 128 and the wedding of Cana in John chapter 2, which fit in very nicely with this particular theme, and to Cortland, who will open his prayers later in the service with the prayer for the week of Christian unity. But as this is the third Sunday in Epiphany, I'm going to use the collect set for today. So let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, mercifully look upon our infirmities, and in all our dangers and necessities, stretch forth thy right hand to help and defend us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if together we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins. Together we say. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent. According to thy promises declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Psalm 128. Happy is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. You shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands. You shall be happy, and it shall go well with you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you see your children's children. Peace be upon Israel.
Together we affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. he descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The New Testament reading is taken from the Gospel of John, chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. On the third day there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were 6 stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory. And his disciples believed in him. This is the Gospel of Christ.
As I said in my introduction at the start of this service, I want to think a little bit today about the week of prayer for Christian unity and the theme of "they showed unusual kindness." Those words are taken from the book of Acts. The week of prayer for Christian unity started in a very small way in 1948, at the end of the Second World War, when different nations were trying to start all over again, right across Europe, whether it was Germany, France, Belgium, or England. A group of Christians, that is clergy and lay people, thought that they also ought to find some way for themselves to show some sort of unity and a better understanding of each other that might help to avoid another war in the future. And from those very simple beginnings with a small vision of just meeting together, 70 years have passed. And the week of prayer for Christian unity has always been in the third week in January. And it's been a time when ecumenically, Christians of all denominations can come together and try really hard to try and understand each other. This year, there's always a theme each year. And as I say, this year's theme is "they showed unusual kindness." Now, I feel that fits in very well, very graciously, actually, with the two readings set for today. In the second reading, where Jesus is invited by his mother to a wedding in Cana of Galilee, Jesus doesn't perform one of those great miracles where rises from the dead, or cures the blind, or cures the deaf, or anything like that. He takes something fairly mundane, something fairly straightforward. They run out of wine, they run out of booze, and as a simple act of kindness, with no judgment on anybody that might have been there, those who were deserving and those who weren't, as a simple act of kindness, he turns those great flagons of water into wine. Now, I think I said last week, that's always been a bit of jokes among clergy, that if you've ever been to Israel and tasted Cana of wine, if Jesus had been around today, he'd have turned the wine back into water. But that's another story. And then we get the psalm which David read for us, Psalm 128. This psalm traditionally written by David. And it's a psalm about the family being the example of the Jewish family, of the importance of the unity between the various generations, that the grandparents is as significant as the newborn child, as the grandchild, the unity of the importance of the family. Now, during the week of Christian unity today, as we try to understand each other better, Christians come together in all kinds of different ways, from great large gatherings to much smaller ones as well. My experience of the week of prayer for Christian unity has always been quite positive, I have to say. There's often been an opportunity, as there was this last week, for clergy to meet together, in our case on Zoom, and to talk about the pandemic and to talk about how that's affected our ministry, our congregations, and how we go about our business as clergy. We understand each other just a little bit better. There have been ecumenical Bible studies set up. There have been opportunities for social events, such as in a small town where Christians, where there might be just a Methodist, a Roman Catholic, and a Church of England church, have come together socially, and they've brought had a bring and share, and they've shared in a wonderful event together. Now, these are all just simple ways in which we can understand each other better and express something about our faith. In a few minutes, Cortland is going to lead us in prayer, and he's going to lead us with the prayer set for the week of prayer for Christian unity. And I'd like to invite you to join in with that prayer as you see it up on the screen. I want you to try and think, as I will try to think, of all those unusual acts of kindness that have girded people together, as together, regardless of race, colour, gender, anything, we've worked together as a nation and as a community to share and look after one another. In that prayer, we can think of the different denominations that we might have some experience of and pray for that part of the Christian community. Let us also remember at this time those of other faiths as well. Our Muslim, Hindu, Sikh friends as well. Their faith is as important to them as our faith is to us. The week of prayer for Christian unity challenges us, but it also gives us reason for hope. We understand each other better, and therefore we'll live out our Christian life that much better.
Let us pray. And let us say together a prayer for Christian unity. Blessed Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "My peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you," consider not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give us that peace and unity which are according to your will, who live and reign with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, now and forever. Amen. Together with Christians of all denominations, we make our prayers of intercession to God. Let us pray. We pray for Archbishop Justin of Canterbury, for Bishop Sarah, Dean of the Chapels Royal, for Pope Francis, the Ecumenical Patriarch, and for all who lead and who minister in the Church throughout the world, that we might all perceive your will for us in these difficult times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for Her Majesty the Queen and all the royal family. We pray for all in positions of authority, local or national, that they might act always for the common good, especially in this time of pestilence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the constable, the governor, the chief yeoman warder, the chaplain, and all who live and work in the Tower of London, remembering especially those coping with challenging personal circumstances as a result of the coronavirus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. We name here Isabel, Rustam, Joe, Rory, John, Lucy, Judy, Neil, Fiona, Pat, Tony, Anthony, Bob, and Ernie. And we pray for all others known to us or for whom we have been asked to pray. We pray also for those who minister to them and for all in the medical and caring professions, giving thanks for their loving kindness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who are close to death and for those who have died, remembering today Fernando. We pray especially for any who have died unexpectedly, including all those who've died from the coronavirus. We pray that all those who mourn may be comforted. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for ourselves. We pray for the time when we may once more be able to meet and to embrace those dear to us. We pray for a spirit of unity with our fellow Christians and kindness towards all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us say together our own prayer in time of the coronavirus. God of love, we ask for your blessing on those who are ill, those who are vulnerable, those who are worried about themselves and those they love, and on those who mourn. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we bring our prayers together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray. Let us pray in this week of prayer for Christian unity, for all those who show unusual acts of kindness. Let us pray for the church throughout the world and for all church leaders. Let us pray that we may all live by the grace of God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. I pray your guardian angel will watch over you and those whom you love. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be with you this day and always. Amen.